Hello, John Talley here with Partzilla.com, and as you can see, we've been doing some work on our 2005 Honda CRF450-R. Today, we're going to dive into the engine. We're going to break it all the way down to the crankshaft and then build it all the way back up. And we're going to be using a kit from Wiseco to accomplish this, but there's a couple other things that we may want to consider as we're going through this. So let's step over to the table and talk about it for a minute. Now we're going to be focused on just doing the top end for this video, but we're using a kit from Wiseco that actually has everything that goes all the way down to the crankshaft. But there's a couple of other things we need to take into consideration as we're doing the top end. As comprehensive as this kit is, there still may be a problem with either the cylinder or the head. So guess what? I've got the cylinder ready to go should we need it. And then a brand new OEM head. Now the good part of the Wiseco kit is it was designed to work with the factory OEM equipment, so these are going to play well together should they be needed. Well, now that we've got all our parts assembled, let's step over and start taking this thing apart. So let's get into it. Let's start off by removing the valve cover itself. Now the cylinder head cover is only held in by 3 10-millimeter head bolts. Now when I'm tearing down one of these, I typically try to lay out everything in sections instead of jumbling it all together, because it's all fun and games when you're pulling it down. But 2, 3, 4 days, maybe even a week later when you go to put it back together sometimes, I don't know about you, but my memory's not quite that strong, so I need to have everything grouped together. And if there's a chance of all this getting mixed up, what I typically do is use a Ziploc and just a Sharpie and group everything together that way. What I want to do first is go ahead and remove this little cover on the side, and we're going to bring it around to top dead center. It's just good practice to do that, even though we are tearing it all the way down. It's just a better way to do it. And we want this on the compression stroke, so that's going to be all the lobes up. And I think we're on the compression stroke right now. It's about 15, 20 degrees off. And I'll show you the timing marks on both the camshaft and then down on the crankshaft as well. So let's go ahead and bring it around. I'm off just a little bit. What you're looking for is that dot to align with that pointer. And what signifies it being at top dead center for the compression stroke is that your cam lobes are facing up and your mark is here compared to your pointer back there. And it looks like Honda even put a little bit of white paint on the cam gear just to make sure. Next, let's get our cam chain tensioner out of the way. Now, I know Honda has a holder that you're supposed to put in here, but we are just going to back it off as is, evenly, because you don't want to just run one of these all the way out, because that'll push against it unevenly and potentially snap it. There we go. Next, let's go and remove our cam gear. And I'm just holding the crankshaft still so we can accomplish that. That's held in by 2 6-millimeter Allens. There's one. Now, if you were doing this with the engine still in the frame, you will have noticed that you can't get to that top bolt. Now, if that's the case, you're going to need to rotate it to where the other one comes into view and then loosen it. Now, at this point, you would want to attach a wire to your cam chain just to keep the chain from dropping down inside the crankcase. And you could fish it out with a magnet, but why make it tougher on yourself than you need to? Next, we're going to do the camshaft assembly holder. We're not taking off the decompression cam or any part of that assembly, so we're going to leave that together. What we're going to do is just loosen each one of these 10-millimeter bolts in 3 or 4 steps to bring it up evenly. And do it in a crisscross pattern. Yeah, no tension on the cam, so we're good. When you lift this off, make sure you don't drop your shim buckets out. And there's your shim. Now the shims, they should stay in the keepers up top. Sometimes they'll stick to the bottom of the bucket. Just be careful. And not drop them down into the crankcase if all you're doing is the top end. Now let's go for these 2 8mm on the head, at the base of the head. Then we're going to go for these 4 14mm, the 4 main nuts that are holding the head down. And you may want to get a longer ratchet like I'm using because it's got a fair amount of torque on it. See if I can hold this thing still. And we want to do this about 1/4 of a turn each so it relieves the pressure evenly. I don't break my arm doing it. All right, looking good so far. Now it should be ready to lift off at this point. I have to give it a little bit of a tap to get it past the dowels. There it goes. I'd say she was running a little bit rich. May have to do something about that. We can get our gasket out of the way. And maybe lift off those 2 dowels. Lift out one of the chain guides. This one actually looks in good shape. I don't see any grooves or anything on it. So I think she can just keep on going. Next, there's just 1 8mm bolt over on the side. Then we'll be ready to lift off the cylinder. There she goes. You can definitely see this one's got some miles on it. Not a horrible amount of wear, but you can see with the skirts, of course in line with the rotation of the crankshaft, they've been eating into the cylinder walls. A little bit of scoring on both sides. That's to be expected. And I'm curious if this was a big bore kit, which may be the case, as I don't think this is a factory piston because the factory piston has an N right here. So next, we're gonna reach in and take out the circlip on one side so we can get our piston out. Now, if you're doing a top end only, it's important that you go ahead and put a towel down here. Otherwise, you drop in the circlip that I'm removing, it's gonna be really tough to get it fished out, because they have a tendency of flying away like that one just did. Now we need to just push the wrist pin through. Now I'm gonna use a 3/8 extension to tap this out, but keep in mind you're tapping against the connector rod and you do not want to bend it. So don't get carried away doing this. Just a light tap is all you should be able to get away with. I'm even using a very light hammer to do this. So what we have here is an aftermarket cylinder and piston kit that was installed on this. It looks like to be standard compression, standard bore, and we can verify that. This is a stock Honda piston for this particular make and model and year. Diameter looks like it's spot on, and the way you can tell if it's a higher compression one or not is to see if the piston height or distance from the wrist pin itself to the top is the same, which it is. And I don't see any protrusions coming up, or a dome, if you will, that would increase the compression ratio. So it looks like it was possibly a forged piston. Nothing really special about it. We can also see a fair amount of wear on the skirts, which you expect to see that, but that looks a bit excessive, and I think I see why. Because you'll notice you've got your oiler rings, or the oil holes on the oil ring, they're there. But what you'll notice when we look at the Wiseco piston that we are going to be using, it actually has those same oil passageways, but then it's got three more over here. Guess what? That is to let oil either in or out to help lubricate those skirts, and then keeps it from actually scoring the cylinder walls. So this is the piston we're actually going to use, and it is just the stock compression ratio, stock diameter, and I could probably hone the old cylinder out, but I really don't know where it came from. I mean, did they, being the manufacturer of this kit, cast their own, because it looks roughly the same as the stock Honda? Is it as good a quality as the stock Honda? I kind of doubt it. So we're going to go ahead and replace the cylinder with a known good one if we're going this far into the engine. But that's basically what they had. They have had an aftermarket setup, probably a decent quality. OEM's fine. I just want to step it up a notch and go with a Wiseco forged piston, new rings, etc., etc. Let's go ahead and invest in a new cylinder. That way I can sleep better knowing that it doesn't have a score mark on the inside of the cylinder. Tell you what, go ahead and pull our shims out. We'll keep them in the correct orientation. But I have a feeling we're going to end up replacing the head as well, because this one, it failed a leak down test. I mean, it had like a 45% loss when I did a quick test on it. And all of that had to be going somewhere. And I don't think it was blowing past the piston. I mean, honestly, this doesn't look like it had really been in there that long. I was quite surprised that it wore off this coating so quickly. But hey, like I said, I don't know the quality of the kit that they had in there. Right, looking at the head, I don't think it's ever been modified. I don't see any sign of it having any type of impact, maybe a bent valve. I mean, everybody looks like they're seated down. We really won't know until we actually pull the valves and take a look at the seats and see if they were actually sealing up like they're supposed to. So we will break this down further in just a little bit. We'll bring out the spring compressor and get those valves out of there. All right, guys, that's going to wrap this one up. Well, listen, if you have any questions or comments, leave them in the section below, and I'll do my best to answer them. And hey, if you like what you see, why don't you go ahead and hit that subscribe button? That way you can keep up with whatever I'm working on next. We just want to say thank you for shopping here with us at Partzilla, and we will see you in the next video. Y'all have a great day.